Sir.
Good evening, friends.
Good evening, sir.
I am very happy to share that what we have decided as a part of our MFFWP program to have a client planner interaction. So I am happy that we have one client with us. His name is Mr. Jayesh Matani, and he works with the one of the leading MNC engineering company. And last year he met me, and we started with the on a goal of the preparing the financial plan. So here we are meeting as a, let's say already we have collected data from the client, and I have prepared the draft financial plan of the Mr. Jayesh Matani. I request Jayesh ji, you can introduce little about yourself, professional background.
My name is Jayesh. I'm a certified project manager and currently working as a chief engineer with one of the leading MNCs engineering consulting firm in India. That's part of the professional part of it. Finance, equity as being part of my interest has always been a subject of liking. And when I try and do a planning of my own self, I found that I was missing something. I could have created more wealth and retired possibly early. That's where I got in touch with Mr. Shah, Mr. Keyur Shah, who has helped me at least you know, put things in place in perspective to achieve my goals in a comfortable way without being panicky about it. I have two kids, age 9 and 6. I stay with my parents, and we have a, you know, a joint family. I need to take care of my kids' education, my retirement, their marriage, and maybe once a year or twice a year vacations.
Okay, good. So, Jayesh ji, I would like to ask one simple question. Ke you are into profession more than approximately 20 years, and you must be saving also every year. Okay, when you started journey with me, almost we have completed 1 year. Okay, so what was the difference between the earlier approach of financial planning or investment and now approach in the financial planning and investment?
Two very startling things is first 10 years there was not enough money to invest, to be very frank, except for a few IPOs which are only placed at par. So that was in the stages where I was guided by many people. There came a stage where I had to ensure that I pay a fixed amount in my LIC endowment plan, which was something my hard-earned money went into it for nearly 15 years. First 5 years was my dad's contribution, the last 10 years was contributed by me. Hardly enough to save except for PPF on a regular basis and endowment plans. With some more funds coming in, I was investing in the markets, and as a person graduates, you would invest, you would do some day trading, you would do into Forex, or you do something in options. That's where brokers will give you all sorts of you know, ways and means to increase their business. You win some, you lose some. At the end of it, I realized if it has to be a long-term growth, I started reading about Warren Buffett. And that's where I, you know, more you know, focused on long-term investing and less of short-term and these measures. And that's where I got in touch with Mr. Shah, and he could help me put things more in perspective. And the change now is I have stopped my endowments, I have taken a term plan, and I have focused on a few mutual funds based on the rankings and the ratings of the fund manager, and invested, I've been starting investing on mutual funds from now on.
Good, very good. So what I would like to give a key message to our listener, specifically classroom as a video learning participant, okay, anyone who start investing, chances that investment goes into the short-term investing like intraday F&O or Forex, and chances that person may lose the hard-earned money capital. And when he meets the basically financial planner, we advise to help to identify, okay, and prioritize the short-term, medium-term, long-term goal. We help to derive the right asset allocation and invest into the suitable mutual fund product, whether it is a debt-based product or equity-based product, to achieve the long-term, we can achieve the financial goal. Now, let me proceed for our discussion. As Jayesh ji briefly introduced, I'll just show for the benefit of video learning participants. So that's how we have created two-page handouts about the income, expenses, asset liabilities, So this is the, again, one more second page of that. Now we have identified and prioritized the goal. So this is the example. Some of the goal is mentioned, like household expense of 35,000 per month, school fees, vacation, outing. Okay, so they have briefly mentioned some of the goals or expenses. So we help as a financial planner. I help to, I you can say, a zero in the exact figure is required. So let's do now. Jayesh ji said that he requires 35,000 at current cost per month when he retires. We calculated the future value, which is 84,000, and for 30 years at a real rate of return of 7% return and 5% inflation, the corpus is required how much? 2,31,00,000. And we have suggested the fixed SIP because he is age of 40 and 58 is the age of retirement. So if we start average SIP 10% return, if we consider average return for 18 years, the SIP will come 40,000 per month. And if we expect the 10% growth in the SIP, then SIP come down to 23,445. So when Jayesh ji, when you first came across with the 40,000 fixed SIP for your one goal, and or you can say increasing SIP 23,000, how did you find? So have you ever thought that you required that much of corpus for retirement only?
Yes, I was a bit more optimistic. I thought maybe 1 crore mein ho jayega.
Okay.
But when I saw this figure, it was like, yes, there was one one moment like, yes, this is something big. But when it was broken down to 40,000 and maybe 23,000, when I increase it on a year-on-year basis, it seems achievable.
Okay.
So that was, yes, that was a hit as well as something to take care of it.
Perfect. So we have seen that 9 out of 10 client or 95 out of 100 client doesn't know what exactly corpus is required when retired from the their private organization or from the self-employment. Okay, where then do not have any basically post-retirement income from the organization. And when you, when we calculate and show the figures, it is a eye-opener. And definitely it is not possible that they can digest in a first hand. Now we will move ahead with the second important goal, where we have a meet higher education and marriage. So now if we go through this goal, I help to zero in the data. Right now he is paying 1 lakh rupees per annum, okay, for the mid current education. So I said that today he is age of 9 year and 5th standard. Okay, then definitely we know that the more the move ahead, the cost of the education is expected to increase. So we consider average 1.5 lakh for 8, 9, 10, then 2 lakh for 11, 12, then 3 lakh for 4 year degree course, then another 5 lakh for 2 years for higher education, post-graduation, and last is the 5 years, 5 lakh for the marriage. So if we consider the return of 10% average and 8% inflation, we required in current terms 29,49,000. Again we have divided into, because we have a 16 years, na, last requirement is six, after 16 years we can go for the SIP, which is the fixed SIP required return of SIP of 29,823, and increasing SIP requires a return of approximately 17,164. So now again for a fixed SIP it is a 30,000 odd, and the increasing SIP at a 9% 17,000. So Jayesh ji, have you ever thought of that because when we deciding you were keeping the 1 lakh rupees average, and then I explained why one should increase the cost of education. So what was your initial reaction? How did you find as a parent?
As a parent, first thing, because this seems now achievable, and with the logical putting the figures and assuming the certain inflation and the growth, which is actually a fact. Because most of the times I do hear people saying, "Jitna hum aaj fee dete ek saal ka, utne mein to pura engineering ho gaya tha hamara."
100%.
So going ahead, due to the scarcity of infrastructure or college, whatever, shortage of teachers and good institutes, we do have a scenario where the cost is increasing. And for going ahead with the competitive world, we need to also go for higher education and post-graduation. And this looks like looks like achievable, but this figure was not clear to me that this is the current cost and this would be eventually the cost. And
okay,
this gives me a more focused approach and makes it achievable, because as I can see, we have taken a conservative return.
Yeah, definitely, because we recommend starting down the line 3 years onward. So for a initial requirement, first 3-5 years we have considered a debt fund. Okay. Then for longer requirement, any mid-term requirement, we have considered balance fund return. And then for a, you can say, post-graduation and the marriage, we have considered the equity return. So I consider average return of 10% to achieve the goal. Definitely for that I have to devise the detailed strategy and I will present to you separately.
Okay.
Because it is not possible right now, okay, I can explain and devise the strategy. Okay, how 10% will be arrived. But in simplicity, as I explained, okay, for initial first, you can say till 12th, we can expect a withdrawal from the debt fund. So that till 12th, we'll be investing in a debt mutual fund. For 13, 14, 15, 16, we will be investing in a balance fund for that amount. And then 17, 18, okay, which is the post-graduation marriage, will be investing for the equity fund. So when we consider what is the average CAGR, it will be a 10% CAGR to achieve the goal. Now we have another requirement, which is the younger son will, you can say, education and marriage. So now if we see same, he is a 6-year-old standard one. We have starting from the, let's say, 8, 9, 10, same 1.5, then 10th, 11, 12, okay, 2 lakh, 8, 9, 10th, it is a, okay, so it is 8, 9, 10, so age is 7, this age is 13, 14, 15, this is a tenure, this again is a tenure, from how long, because we are, I had to make multiple data, this is a standard, this is a tenure, this is the age, so when he will be in standard 8, 9, 10, it is a 1.5 lakh each, 11, 12, 2 lakh each, 13, 14, 15, 16, standard, it is a graduation 3 lakh each, and then again post-graduation 5 lakh each, and marriage is again 5 lakh after 19 years when he becomes age of 25 lakh. So when same scenario, we have used 10% CAGR and the 8% inflation, we got 27 lakh rupees corpus today. And if we divide in 19 years, so it is a 25,980, 26,000 SIP. And if we increase by 9%, we got a 13,643 SIP. So if we combine the three goal requirement, if we combine the three goal requirement are one, and one more before we combine, we have an insurance requirement also. So as we know that 35,000 is household expense, expected lifetime is 85, and we have used ROR 7 and 6. So we got 1 crore 62 lakh rupees for the replacement for the monthly household expense, and approximately another 60 lakh rupees for the children higher education marriage, which will come to a 2.2 crore. So now he is my client more than 1 year. So you have already, how much cover you have?
1.75.
So 1.75. Okay, 1.75. You bought a 1.5 crore term plan last year. Okay, so now we know that there is a 50 odd lakh rupees shortfall is there. That can be manageable by buying additional 50 lakh rupees or 1 crore term plan. Now if we add our calculation, which are the three need-based, we are not talking any want-based goal. One is the retirement, one is the second is children higher education, and third is the marriage. So combined SIP required is, we have calculated, this is the combined SIP required per month at a growth of average 9%, which is a 54,000 rupees. Now today current take home income is approximately 12 lakh rupees per annum, 6 lakh rupees is the household expense and EMI, 2 lakh rupees is school fee, 1 lakh rupees miscellaneous. So we have only how much surplus we have per month, approximately 25,000 per month. So now we have to work out how we can provide the alternatives, how we can help our client, because we come to know that per month availability of fund is 25,000 per month, and we require approximately 54,000 SIP. So when we calculated, when we visited assets and liability, we come to know there is a one asset is there, house, and which value is approximately maybe between 90 lakh to 1 crore. This house is under right now, is expected to be in redevelopment. It is a JSG bought in 2003 or 4 at a price of 10-12 lakh, and now it is a 90-100 lakh, but it is a vacant because you are not staying there, okay. And redevelopment is expected in future. So right now, in preference to the house, we do not get any rental. Second, it is a expected for rent redevelopment. Suppose if we move in a redevelopment under 5 years, again until we get the house reconstructed, one may not able to sell. So we have suggested our client ki one bold solution. I am talking about the bold solution. Okay, that is the I am talking about first bold solution. Ki one client can, Jayesh bhai can sell that house. I have earmarked only 80 lakh because maybe there is a taxation is involved when house is sold. So we may have to pay 10 lakh tax, 80 lakh rupees in our end. And then if we minus 1 and 2 requirement, which is the primary requirement, higher education and marriage of both, and we have a 23 lakh rupees in place. So now 23 lakh rupees is with us. If we divide this 23 lakh rupees in 3 part today, so one, we can have a 10 lakh rupees fund which is available for our hobbies or vacation. Jayesh bhai can withdraw every year systematically to fulfill their hobby for another next 10-20 years. 10 lakh rupees can be earmarked for the retirement purpose to achieve that corpus, and whatever the surplus we have right now, 25,000, which also can be invested for the retirement purpose. But as I said, it is a bold solution. So what is your first feeling when you listen that solution from me? Yes, Jayesh bhai.
First reaction was, we have an asset and it's going to appreciate in value. After 3 years, it could be fetching a better value, the market price is going up. So, as you said, it's really a kind of a bold kind of a thought. I haven't given a thought about it, but it could be one of the things can be taken decision at a later date. I know it's an illiquid thing. The market values keep on fluctuating, so needs a rethink, but looks very interesting to think about it.
Okay, but Jayesh, as you know that real estate sector is already overvalued, and rental yield today is fetching less than 2% across the Mumbai or across the metro city. And way the concept of smart city is building in our country, our government saying that we will not have a few city or smart, you can say a few pockets where the development, it is like a across the board 100-200 smart cities. Okay, so there are chances that people may not require a long traveling. People may be sitting in Palghar and doing a job in Palghar or in Virar or maybe in Kalyan, Panvel or maybe in Nasik, etc. So in that condition, if I may not require to travel, okay, in a heart of the city, okay, there is a chance of a not appreciation. Today we are facing same situation in South Mumbai side, specifically in commercial sector, commercial rental. Nobody like to rent it out the property in Nariman Point, which was the peak in 1990, 350 per square feet rental. Now it is only a 50 per square feet, and today even the building is not, and tenants don't want to come because my customers have been shifted to a suburb or a remote part. So I have to be with my customer, my employee. So in that condition, do you find that yes, there is a same kind of potential is there, because last 10-12 years, yes, maybe 15% CAGR you earn or market has delivered, but is it expected the same CAGR will continue in future?
Difficult to say whether the market will continue the way it is. No denial about it. But to take up an asset which has been bought with a purpose, it has served a purpose to so extent, but because it is in a condition where we cannot stay because the structure is weak, and that's the reason it is, you know, vacant. Else it could have been rented out at this point of time. But selling off a property will be a decision which has to be taken jointly. At this stage, yes, with the SIP and making it grow over a period of time, because upskilling myself and increasing the avenues of generating income would be my focus primarily, is what I have.
Definitely, I fully
agree. But yes, at the back of the mind, this remains as a strategy.
Hmm. So if you opt for the regular option, as we have decided today, we have 54K SIP, okay, and if you manage even 44K per month, example, okay, and again, this is expected to grow at a 9% also.
Right.
So in that condition, suppose whatever you earn, okay, any take-home salary after the basic expenses is going to be invested for the pursuing the, and to achieving the three goals, both sons, higher education, marriage, and third is the about retirement. So you may not have any surpluses available to pursue the hobby or maybe doing some discretionary expense or vacation planning. So
yes,
chances that suppose in this condition, example, you know, conservative note, if there is no substantial improvement in the income, okay, which you did as you said last time, okay, you got maybe approximately 100% rise in salary when you shifted to one organization to another organization. So in case if it is not happen and if you continued with the same organization or in same profile and earning 9%, so chances that you may be a asset rich, but you may have a shortage of the cash.
Yes, I can foresee that if that continues the way as you mentioned. But I always keep a pursuit of upskilling myself and exploring new avenues. And that is what keeps me busy.
So my objective is not to basically think negative, but have to keep in both option in mind. One is opt for the regular option, keeping in mind that I exponentially increase my income, okay, and part of that money will be invested to fund the three important goal, okay, and because my income is exponentially increased, maybe 15% CAGR example, if you take it in simplicity 15%, so I have a balance amount which is used for the my recreational and discretionary expense. And second option is that key, if I want to take it a bold decision, then the I may liquidate the my real estate, and which gives me a one kind of a freedom that I am not basically creating a basically investing a big amount every month which is increasing at particular rate to just to serve the children's education, marriage and retirement goal. Now when I gone through the your detail, I have also marked one thing, right now we don't have any monthly SIP going. Why? Any specific reason?
Yeah, specific reason is I don't have a monthly SIP, but I do it arbitrarily. I don't do it on a regular basis, so it's not SIP, and it's not monthly definitely.
But what is the
reason being something or the other unplanned expenses which come up. It could be a car's maintenance, it could be some medical emergencies. And that's the reason I'm not locked in with any of these asset management companies.
That's why, as we know that keep car maintenance, we have car insurance for a medical claim, it will take the medical expenses.
Agreed. I do have a family floater cover, which includes all members of my family.
Mm-hmm.
But at times we do, you know, put up the check immediately on an emergency basis. Of course, it is reimbursable.
Hmm.
And I that's the reason I keep away from putting automatic mode.
I understand your point of view, but I give you one solution which will help you to avoid that worry also. So what is the I can suggest, we can continue with the at least 25k SIP as we can
yes.
afford right now, okay,
yes.
And which will increase. because SIP, when you do every month, it will create a one kind of culture of regular savings.
Correct.
Okay, and basically whenever there is a fund is in our bank account, it is expected we spend maybe discretionary spending, maybe some emotional impulse spending is then. Okay, so we may not able to generate the convert into investment. Even there is no problem in throughout the year, even though we have not invested full 3 lakh rupees. So that is the I strongly suggest, without thinking of the negative event, what you must start immediately 25,000 SIP. I'll suggest which are the five fund will go based on large cap, mid cap, multi cap, etc. And what I can suggest, as you said that ki you have a already a direct equity, na? How much you have direct equity today?
Direct equity portfolio is close to around 7.5.
Like, and how much right now you have in mutual fund?
Mutual fund and equity combined is 7.5 lakhs.
So now I can suggest there is a one product with the private sector bank which is known as a LAS. It is known as a loan against security. So okay, when you pledge this share, okay, they will give you 50% credit. Okay, credit means that you market value example 7.5, so you can withdraw 3.7.5 lakh and they will give you a checkbook and debit card also.
Okay,
it is like a LAS account, loan against securities account, and interest is also lowest. Today is less than 10%. And what is the again advantage, if you use for only 1 week, you will be paying a 10% per annum interest for only 1 week only.
Okay,
so what happened that you have not even locked your fund for the contingency requirement. Okay, same time your fund is earning a good return 12 to 15%, and you have just opened the one LAS account, okay, where you have paid some processing fee of 3-4 thousand first year at a time of opening, and then it is a recurring expense of 500 to 1000 rupees per annum. So by this way you have created one contingency cover of maybe a 3.5 lakh to 4 lakh, or whenever market increases your eligibility will automatically increases. So you have created a contingency cover of 3.5 lakh fund, and you can withdraw anytime by writing a check or withdrawing from the ATM, etc. And same time your investment is undisturbed, and you need not to withdraw from your investment.
Yeah.
And you are also paying the lowest interest because bank is assured that you have placed your securities. So have you ever heard this concept? Okay, so I help you to open this LAS account. It's a very interesting concept. I always discuss with my basically client and help them to have a LAS account to take care of the contingency requirement, as well as for the some kind of financial emergency or some kind of medical emergency. So that's how, what we are doing, we are investing 25,000 as are as a regular investor, and whenever we have a more income, we can top up the SIP. We can increase every year as per our income. So this is the right now I am offering solution to you to start a first one SIP. Any question you have in your mind right now?
Nothing.
No. Okay, and so now let conclude the our current meeting, as we have prepared the draft financial plan of our client based on the case study we have prepared. We have helped client to zero in the even how much current cost is required to achieve the recurring education, higher education and marriage goal. We have calculated the corpus and calculated the SIP, okay, which is a fixed as well as increasing SIP, and we have offered the two solution. One is the bold solution, okay, and second is the regular solution. And we have tried to even explain to client that you must do a systematic investment, because as you are select person getting a fixed salary per month, okay, so if you are doing a SIP, it will help you to save regularly as well as avoid the unnecessary impulse or you can say discretionary expenses, and to you can say avoid the fear of contingency, or to basically take care of contingency requirement, we have suggested LAS account. So now I'll quickly guide how I suggest five fund. So I'll suggest broad asset allocation you must invest your 50% or at least 40% in a large cap fund, because we know that large cap stock are more stable, like TCS, Infosys, Reliance Industry, or top 100 companies, which is giving you a stable return of based on the past performance, what I have shared last time to you. Okay, you can expect average 12% return. Then same time we can take a concept of multi-cap fund. Okay, in multi-cap fund we can get the investing in large cap, mid cap, small cap also, and then 5k we can opt for the either if you want to inclination toward mid cap or small cap or maybe a particular sectoral fund. So when we invest this way, we are getting a exposure of on average 60-70% in large cap and 30-40% in a small to mid cap sector. So we can generate a good return between 12-15% in a long term. And when I suggest fund to you, we will suggest based on the one important concept of Jensen Alpha. So Jensen Alpha is the excess return generated by the fund over the benchmark. So we have identified funds. So I'll work it on which are the right now good Jensen Alpha fund, which has proven a good track record in a 3 years basis, 5 year basis. Okay, and I'll give you some three option in each large cap, multi cap, and one in mid cap, small cap, or sectoral fund. Then we'll zero in the which fund we need to invest. Any questions right now?
No, I need to review this or I need to keep a monitoring on these funds, or it's just like
no, definitely as a financial planner, it is my duty every 6 months I have to check the basically if any change in catastrophic change in the particular fund. Okay, because we know that key example, if I have given a one particular fund based on the past performance, because fund manager is delivering the good return, but due to some reason fund manager has left the organization, okay, and moved to the another organization. In that condition, if you find that new fund manager may not having the equivalent capabilities, okay, so we may suggest you to move from that particular fund, okay, and to select the another fund, or we may find that one fund is doing a good and we can identify another fund which can do a better job than that particular fund. So we can do a regularly 6 month review. It is known as a basically rebalancing kind of thing, which will help you to make sure that we are constantly invested in good fund. I am talking about best fund. We are not behind the best fund. We are on a good fund. So that good fund will deliver our expected return to achieve the goal. So definitely right now we have suggested only 10% asset allocation. So right now I have just taken only equity part of asset allocation, which is a 25,000, and rest we can say if we go for total investment of 55,000, then because our objective is to generate the 10%, so then I can suggest the one is PPF. As you are working in organization, you can pour in EPF. Yeah. It is an exam. Okay, and approximately 8% return you can expect. So you can first complete your PPF and you can invest more amount in your voluntary EPF also, and then balance amount you can invest into a debt mutual fund. So if we invest 25 and 35, where here we are getting average return of 8% and here getting an average return of 12%, so in a long term average you can generate the 10% return. So that's how our objective to achieve the 10% return for your either retirement goal or children higher education, children marriage, etc. Okay, any queries right now?
No.
Okay, thank you very much. So now friends, let's start with the key learning. So we met, okay, Jayesh bhai is our you can say a client, and when he started the this activity, okay, and now today we have zero in with the draft financial plan. So I would like to ask, what are the one or key takeaways he would like to share with us as a client?
Key takeaways, I would say the goals are always there in front of us. The target of, you know, scoring six runs per over was always there. But this actually gave me a strategy to ensure that each batsman, whether he is in form or out of form, will make 6 runs in an over so that we achieve our target of winning the match. Because at the end of it, we all want to win the match. And this gives us a pathway or a route or a perspective and a guided path to reach that magic figure. That was my key takeaway. Retirement and kids, higher education and marriage, prime goals, which looks like they are achievable now. Earlier, I was not too sure, nor was the path that clear. As I say again, this puts us on a winning path.
Okay, Advait, what are your key learnings from this discussion?
So key learnings that we should be able to provide the client various options which can be done to achieve his goals, mm-hmm. and not be forcing him to take a particular kind of decision. Mm-hmm. And as sir said that we are going to helping him select the good fund, not promising the best returns. We are mm-hmm. not there to hit success mm-hmm. For the complete over. We are mm-hmm. there to win the match at the end of the day.
Good, very good, Tejal.
I like the pen and paper approach, the way you were explaining him, and then you divided into 3 goals on basis of which is you prioritize the goals, and it was you gave him options as to where he has to invest, or you suggested him to sell his house. So the different options you provide, and you are not focusing mainly on the higher returns. Mm. Mostly clients focus that you provide higher returns, but a focus here was on giving a proper average return, a good average return of 10 to 15%.
Very good. Yes, Ashi.
So normally clients have an objection in the sense of an issue that once we invest, what after that? So as a certified financial planner, you said that you'll be reviewing the portfolio every 6 months. So that is beneficial. Clients also stay satisfied that yes, my portfolio is being reviewed, and then rebalance if it is required to generate the good returns, constantly good returns. So that was the part I liked, and then asset allocation, which you suggested him as per his needs, was amazing.
Good.
I like the hand holding part. I mean, from the start, which you started from the inflation, you took into consideration, you took the returns into consideration, you took the asset allocation into consideration. You said, I mean, there are various ways to invest, there are various, large cap funds or mid cap funds, whatever client is comfortable. So, I like the hand holding part from the time when you explain the client what is the inflation and what are the corpus required for the particular goal. So, I found that more interesting in the
Okay,
as per the goals, sir, we calculated the SIP. Mm. So it was difficult for sir to manage that because it was very high. Mm. So as you did increasing SIP, so sir, it encouraged sir to do because it was half by that. So it motivated again to do the SIP. Means yeah, we can achieve that by increasing SIP.
Good. Okay, now let me share my own learnings because Jayesh bhai is my client. What I have basically found, okay, so if I just share one by one, let's see ke, as Jayesh bhai honestly shared that basically when he started in market investment, he started with the initially in intraday F&R forex. So it is with everyone, okay, but the more you fast learn that this is not right and you identify what is right and follow that, it is the important, okay. So that he was doing maybe for a small amount, okay, but he stopped now, and now he is either investing in a direct equity or maybe in mutual fund for long term horizons only, okay. Even now he has decided not to build more portfolio in direct equity but more portfolio in a equity mutual fund, because again there is a individual, we have a limitations. It is not possible for me to do a required research before investing in a particular stock, okay. So it is better if I give my money to a professional fund manager. He has a far better knowledge and skill set, so he can generate the. So that's the reason we have decided this 55,000 per month, where 30,000 into debt mutual fund or maybe into debt assets, and another 25,000 which is into a equity asset. So we can invest all 55,000 into professional only, okay. Specifically 25,000 equity is through professional fund manager, And third, what I observe, in morning also we met Advait's father, okay, during the one kind of parents feedback, and we also found that he was not investing in SIP, or he doesn't have a single rupee in SIP. Here, client is young, client knows, okay, about the benefit of investing in equity, but again there is a you can say hesitation for the SIP, okay, and we know that SIP is the one of the, you can say, instrument which gives you a cost averaging also. You can average your cost of buying. Same time, you don't know when you are investing and how much you created wealth. If you want to create a really good wealth without a kind of worrying, okay, so if you start investing, example, right now, if we start investing 25,000 per month, after 1 year, he might also forget that it is going in automatic mode and he is managing his some contingency expenses through LS account, and he is creating a wealth in 10 years down the line or 5 years down the line. He will find it is a more systematic approach than every 3 month review how much corpus I have and then invest into the particular stocks or particular equity investment. Anything you would like to add right now?
No.
Okay, so I thank you very much, Jayesh ji, Jayesh Matani ji, to come on a short notice and share his basically draft financial plan with us for our educational purpose or the learning for classroom as well as video learning participants. So I thank you very much, and Jayesh bhai, we have one small moment of for you. So I request you accept this moment of from us.